My neighbor is one of those annoying wannabe YouTube personalities. Over the years, I've seen him cough out cinnamon, lay flat on the hood of his car as it slowly creeps down the driveway, and douse himself in lukewarm water, all the while screaming, "Epic win, epic fail, or fuck, epic maintenance of the status quo, for all I know." It can get tiring to watch him go about his shenanigans in the pursuit of viral fame. So, when he knocked on my door the other day, told me he was going away for a few weeks, and asked that I get his mail, honestly, it was a relief. I can't explain the peace of mind I had knowing I didn't have to brace myself for any of his stupidity for quite a while. I was always afraid his stunts would wind up bleeding over into my life somehow. Things were pretty normal for the first couple of days. He received a few bills, a bit of spam, and what I could only assume was a birthday card. Then, one evening, I got home to find a cardboard box waiting on his front porch. In big red letters was written, "Return to Sender." I'm no small fry, but I admit I had trouble lifting the box on my own. It was really freaking heavy. Lugging it across the road to my house was even harder, and I quickly realized that there was no way I was going to drag it up the stairs and through my front door. I decided I'd leave his package in my garage. It wasn't like I kept my car in there. The garage door was a piece of shit that refused to open without a good thug and a good whack. It was less trouble just leaving the car in the driveway than it was to fight with the garage door every morning and night. In hindsight, I should have set the package down while I struggled to open the tricky door. But you know how it is when you've got a good grip on something. No point in setting it down if you don't have to. It was as I kicked the door for a third time that I lost my grip on the package and it fell to the ground. I heard a light crack inside. "Shit," I cursed. I hoped I hadn't broken anything important, but I figured I just wouldn't tell my neighbor about it and let him assume the break happened en route. Hands free, I finally managed to get the garage door unstuck, and boy did it screech in protest as it rolled up and over me. I dragged the box the rest of the way, setting it in the corner for whenever my neighbor would come back to claim it. And then, I forgot all about it. Until a few days passed, that is. I'm not sure exactly how long it took for the smell to waft in from the crack under the garage to the house door, but it came in a slow progression. It was a sickly sweet odor, similar to a skunk, and for the first few days after I smelt it, I genuinely assumed that's exactly what it was. Roadkill that had left its mark on my house. It was only when I realized that the scent was growing more intense instead of fading that I went looking for a source. That's when I opened the garage door, and that's when the odor knocked me back, holding my nose. The culprit wasn't hard to identify. The only change in my garage was the box in the corner. I remember thinking it must have been one of those meat of the month subscription boxes. The meat must have gone rancid from being left out of the fridge for so long. How much meat could have been in there for the box to have been so large and heavy? An entire freaking cow? I covered my nose as I approached the box, a pair of scissors in my hands. I probably wouldn't have needed them to open it, as it had become soggy enough at the bottom to poke through with a finger. But I wasn't about to poke my finger into spoiled meat juices. The soggy bottom was the reason I had to open the box in the first place. If I tried to drag it out whole, everything would spill out onto the floor. I was going to have to dump the pieces of meat one garbage bag at a time, and take them down to the dumpster, a process I wasn't looking forward to. My scissors tore through the tape along the top of the cardboard box. I thought the smell couldn't get any worse, but as I flipped the flaps open, I discovered a whole new gamut of stink. It was like opening a burning oven, but instead of a heat wave, I was met with waves of piss, sweat, shit, and putrefaction. It was so bad that I staggered back and had to force down the puke, begging to guzzle out of me. I don't think I could have handled that scent mingling with the horrors coming out of the box. I'm not ashamed to admit I ran out of the door for a breath of fresh air, but in the short time I'd spent in the garage, the smell had become so ingrained in the fabric of my clothes that it clung to me like a shadow. Nothing I tried could keep the smell out of my nostrils. Not air fresheners, not a face mask, not 3 showers and a change of clothes. Every second that box lay open in my garage was another second the smell was allowed a foothold into my home. I had to bite the bullet. I returned to the garage, the flaps of the box still open, as though inviting me to look. I was prepared, a clothespin pinning my nostrils shut, a garage bag in one hand, and the strongest cleaner I could find in the other, and long rubber gloves to keep my skin from having to touch what was inside. But as it turns out, I needed none of those things. I wouldn't have to touch or clean the contents of that box. I would only have to suffer the nightmares every night. You see, there was meat in the box, but it didn't come from a cow or a pig. No, it was worse than that. It was my neighbor. Dead. Still in one piece, but dead. I called the cops, and naturally, they took me in for interrogation. It's kind of hard not to suspect the man with the corpse in his garage, after all. Thankfully, they soon realized I wasn't involved. My DNA might have been all over that box, the smell might have left a mark throughout my house, but there was one piece of irrefutable evidence in my neighbor's own hands that proved my innocence. A vlogging camera. They showed me the footage only once. I'm not sure if they were allowed to, or if they felt so bad for me, they figured it couldn't hurt. Either way, I saw it. My neighbor was sitting in the box outside of a shipping facility, laughing as he told the world how he was going to mail himself across state lines. He'd brought pee bottles, food, a pillow, and a few flashlights. His friend, a guy I'd seen at his place several times to help him with his stunts, closed the lid and presumably drop him off for shipment. Throughout the next couple of hours, or days, I'm honestly not sure, my neighbor recorded a few short clips about his progress. I think I'm in a truck now. I can feel it moving. Must be in a warehouse. Pretty warm here. Still got plenty of food. That kind of stuff. And then on the last entry, the box toppled over. He broke his neck, and that was it. The camera recorded until either the memory card got too full, or the battery died. There's one thing I didn't tell the police after they showed me the video. One thing I heard in the footage that will haunt me to the day I die. Just after the tumble that broke his neck, I heard the familiar screeching sound of my garage door. The lock was useless. The bellboy knew it. The bartender knew it. The whole hotel knew it. All locks are useless, eventually. They create safes to be broken into. What happens when you lock yourself out? Most thieves simply steal a safe rather than immediately breaking into it. What would happen if we made a safe uncrackable? The real question is, how much do you trust that no human will eventually err? Forget a number, lose a key, break a key. The possibilities are truly limitless. I'm not sure how I found the hotel non dormiant, but there it was, just beside the highway, towering above the surrounding area. It looked strange since there was nothing for miles. Then suddenly, this archaic castle mansion hybrid, taken from the 1920s with upwards of 20 floors, appears beside the road. My phone had no signal, but the sign said they had Wi-Fi. I checked in that night, since I needed a place to stay in between jobs. It wasn't exactly inconspicuous, but it would do. The bellboy was quiet, not much for small talk. He seemed to be talking, but I could only assume it wasn't to me, since the only thing that came from his mouth was a soft murmur, just too faint to hear. I brought too much, but the bellboy didn't flinch, his back didn't bend, and his form didn't suffer. I didn't expect to stop at the hotel. In fact, I didn't even think there were any hotels on this stretch of road, but a combination of losing service, missing my turn, and fatigue hitting me like a jet engine forced me to stay. I thanked him, closed my door, and immediately noticed the decor. You know the typical hotel room. Outdated TV, old landline, Bible in the nightstand. This hotel, though, was very different. They did have an outdated TV, but it didn't seem to be playing anything that I knew of. In fact, some of those shows I'd literally never even heard of. The phone wasn't functional. The room was thematic. I ended up going to the bar, passing by a maid cleaning a room across the way. She had a shaved head, and was working diligently. Either she didn't notice my gaze on her, or she didn't care. I entered the elevator, mentioned to the elevator operator I'd like to go wherever the bar was. He nodded, and the next thing we know, the doors were opening to the most beautiful room I've ever seen. I walked in, went up to the counter, and his gaze tended down weary, almost. He asked what I'd like, while already pouring my drink. Bourbon on the rocks. How'd he know? I took a sip. He didn't look the type. Tired as I was, I started to listen in, try to get some history of this place. Apparently, the woman three seats over was from Jacksonville, and her car broke down about an hour away from Disney World. Right when she managed to pull off, she saw this massive building, and she checked in, hoping to use Wi-Fi to connect with the tow truck since she didn't have any service. The tow truck never came. The man in the booth right behind me was taking a vacation in Texas when he ended up making an unscheduled stop here to break the trip in half. The bartender motioned at me, and I walked over. I asked for his name, but he just pointed to his badge. Bartender. Of course, one of those hyper-professional types. I went back to my room, nursing a good buzz. The room looked different this time. There was a mirror near the closet. It had swirls along the sides of it, and some symbols I couldn't decipher near the top. Since the maid was moving through the rooms on this floor earlier, I figured she'd place it here. I couldn't quite figure out why she'd placed it there, but she must have. I went to sleep. I dreamt of a sea with my bed in the middle, waves pushing and pulling, each changing my bed in some way. At first, they were hands. Each wave made a new hand sprout up through the sheets, and each pulled back into the ocean, made them disappear, vanish. Next, the waves were arms, thousands of arms, pushing my bed up. I recognized the numbers on these arms. Many of them had 200 sprawled across them, and twisted and mangled letters. Then, they were faces, thousands of faces, layering in all directions, screaming. They were part of my bed. They made up the boats, the rocks, the moon. The moon was smiling in a crooked smile as the arms started to grab me, trying to pull me in. I woke up, screaming, sweat, covering my bed. Patches of my bed looked scratched, beaten up, weathered. I swear it didn't look like that when I checked in. Hopefully I won't get charged when I check out. I'll plead ignorance, or just lie. The phone rang. I pulled the phone off the receiver and put it up to my ear. "You have room service at your door," a sharp voice stated matter-of-factly, and then abruptly hung up. I went to the door, passing by the mirror, now slightly ajar. There stood the bellboy, bringing me a bottle of red rum with some sweet cake. I asked how much it cost, and more importantly, who ordered it, but he didn't answer. He merely brushed it aside and walked away. I stood there with salty and damp clothes in bewilderment. I'd had about enough for one day. It was time to leave. I gathered my excessive belongings and headed downstairs. The desk was empty. After assaulting the bell to get their attention, the same woman with the clipboard who checked me in came out. She looked lost, confused even. I decided I'd leave my keys at the desk and head out, on to the next job. I pushed open the door and ended up walking into room 555. What happened? Why couldn't I leave? Why does the bellboy refuse to speak to me? My ego was wearing down and my sanity quickly following. Frazzled, I went back to the bar. On the way over, that's where I met him. His gaze was fixed on me, looking guilty. I wasn't sure of what, but I could see it in his eyes. He was trapped. Something was pulling his body by strings, and he looked helpless, but also completely in control. When you meet someone like Charles Manson, they usually seem apathetic, vaguely proud. He didn't. I walked to the bar, and there he was, staring at his drink, baffled. "Hey there, what's your name?" "Quickly," he replied, "Sam." His gaze didn't lift. He was still stirring the ice around his drink, hood covering his face. "What room are you in, Sam?" His gaze shifted upwards, and for just a moment, I caught it. 200, he replied, hesitantly. I remembered those sprawlings, those arms, those faces, that fear. 200 was important. I'm not sure how. Maybe I'll never know. But it was. He was related to those screaming. Maybe what tormented them torments him. "Hey, can you do me a favor?" His eyes lifted and now had something about them. Something dark. "Do you know anyone who can pick a lock?" I knew just the guy. He mentioned that he went exploring the previous day and there was something interesting about this hotel. Not only was it full of oddities, but he mentioned that the 17th floor was completely sealed shut, under lock and key. He wanted to break in. A simple task requiring a simple skill. We need to break through that lock. My specialty. We decided to go the following morning. That night, a similar dream invaded, drifting in through the locks, escaping my dream eater. I saw them again. This time I was in a field. Corn abound. Miles and miles of grain with those screams echoing in a chorus around me. Their faces covered my entire vision, with each scream creating a symphony that pierced my ears, hitting some part of my subconscious. They looked fearful, but most importantly, they looked like they gave up long ago. Something inhuman, as well as uniquely human, dwelled here. I couldn't help but think they were real. In all honesty, they seemed realer than real. Their arms started to reach out, grabbing me and pulling me in all directions. I ran, weaving and wafting through the endless stalks of corn. After what felt like hours, I finally broke free of their arms. I felt violated, but the faces were still there, and that screaming, those helpless, hopeless eyes. They stared. I arrived at a road and immediately started running. I saw a man, standing resolutely in my way. I ran to him, frantic and panicking, but he didn't react. "You shouldn't be here." His voice boomed with an unfamiliar type of certainty. His words rang true. I was here in a dream, with faces in all directions, a symphony of pain echoing through my mind. "How do I leave?" I asked, desperately. "You can't anymore. You crossed that threshold long ago. You don't belong here, but you will soon." He melted into the road, and the faces in the cornfield started coming closer, forming a tunnel over me, judging. The next thing I knew, I saw his face, the bartender, staring at me from one of the stalks. I awoke to a thundering knock on the door. My room looked dirty. There were tracks of mud everywhere, with footsteps leading all over the walls. Even the ceiling had its fair share of marks. Sam was outside. His lips met his ears. It was time. We had to take the stairs since the elevator operator wouldn't take us near floor 17. The attendant watched us entering the stairs with apprehension on his face. Quickly, I realized that a trip to the gym would have helped. I was nearly breathless by floor 9, but we had 8 more floors to go. We didn't see anyone as we went up the stairs. Of course we wouldn't, I realized, since the only reason to take the stairs was to get to the forbidden floor. The floor the elevator didn't have a button for. The floor they don't let you stay in. Floor 17. Finally, we got to the door. After a few minutes of playing with the locks, we heard a click. "Easy." His eyes brightened, and for the first time, he didn't look so trapped. We opened the door, fighting through a layer of cobwebs that sealed the door shut. "What the hell?" I recoiled as I saw those same people in my dreams, those same faces covering the walls. What is it? Sam wasn't staring at those same faces I was. He was focused on a different corner of the room. Even when asking, his gaze was unflinching. His fear welled up. The walls were muttering. Shadows covered the corners with spiders in every crevice. Instead of eyes, each bulb had that familiar face. That desperate, familiar face. That symphony. I awoke in my bed, cobwebs covering my whole body. I was in some type of cocoon. With all my strength, I pushed my arms outward, breaking the seal. I walked through the room with shadows all around me. I looked at the mirror, covered in webs. I cleared them off, terrified, and saw my reflection, smiling. If you're reading this, please help me. I'm stuck in room 555, and no matter how hard I try, I can't get out. I've tried the bar. I've tried leaving the hotel. I've tried everything. I've found the one lock I can't break, and it's keeping me trapped. If you find the hotel in some nondescript part of the world, please visit room 555. I finally got out of the mirror, but I can't get out of this room. Maybe, just maybe with your help, I can be free. And you can take my place.